I teach you. Alright, we're gonna see the next part on chapter 15, okay? Now we will first look a bit about tax planning, concept only, huh? And then we learn very basic things about tax planning, okay? First of all, we understand these two terms. You probably come across the word evasion and avoidance. Tax evasion and tax avoidance. Okay, what's the main difference between evasion and avoidance? Now, so most people will tell you the key difference between evasion and avoidance is the legality. Evasion is illegal. Okay? For example, you cheat, you do fraud. Now, a lot of those uncle auntie, they go and find those so-called not so straightforward accountant. Then they will tell them, hey, my tax is coming. So usually the right way of doing tax is what? You give them your income and they calculate. But this one, terbalik one, right? You will tell the accountant, I want to pay 500 this year. Then the accountant will do indirect record, incomplete record. From 500, they work backward and say, you earn this much this year. Can you see that? Now, obviously, this kind of way of doing is evasion. That if you're caught, we can charge you, okay? So if we charge you, we can charge you using 114. We will learn this when we look at tax admin. And 114 is a criminal offense. That means you can go jail, okay? So this is evasion. Now, smart one, they don't have to evade taxes to save tax. The smarter one can avoid taxes to save tax. And the main difference is avoidance is legal. You cannot say I'm wrong, because you're not. So avoidance is legal. So this is a legal way. So how do you avoid taxes? Now, basically, we try to exploit the loophole of the law. Because you know law is wording. Okay? Anything to do with wording, alright? And Malaysia, we are looking at the wording of the law. We don't look at the intent of the law. That's why we don't actually go into looking behind what's the intention of the law was being created. We just look at the wording of the law. That if the words you interpret is this meaning, then it has to be like that. Because you know, even though that the intention was not like that, but it doesn't matter. You don't have to look at intention. That's Malaysian law. Because you know, so if you can see the loophole of the law, you exploit. So I always make fun of this example. Okay. Like you see a road, you look at the sign put there, no entry. You drive in, it's wrong, can you see not? So we don't enter, we reverse in, can you know? Reverse and enter is different, right? So that's something, that kind of concept that we're trying to say, okay? So we just play around with this kind of loophole. So when you want to avoid taxes, how do you avoid? Now we avoid either by eliminating. That means totally don't pay the tax. Alright, we eliminate so you don't pay the tax. We can reduce. We can defer. Pay less tax or pay later. Okay, so these are all part and parcel of different ways of doing avoidance. Okay. Now, the government also know that the law got a lot of loophole. And sometimes the law got loophole because it's intended to, that they want to give some privilege to certain people. But you guys are smart enough to exploit it. So that's why what the government tried to do is while trying to extend this kind of tax benefit to one class of people, they may try to stop another class of people to exploit them. So what happened is they come out with anti-avoidant law. So, the government has anti-avoidant law. Because as I say, tax avoidance is legal. So they cannot punish you. Can you see, you know? So what they can do is they can come up with another set of law to stop you from avoiding. That's what it's called anti-avoidant law. Okay? Now when we look at anti-avoidant law, there are actually two types of anti-avoidant. I think I write down here, okay? Now, there are two types of anti-avoidance. Okay. One is general tax anti-avoidance. The other one is a specific anti-avoidance. So what's the main difference between a general anti-avoidant and a specific anti-avoidant? Now, see, an easier way for us to distinguish is we look at the part on being discretionary or mandatory. Now, if something is specific, the anti-avoidance law will be mandatory. That the moment you look at it, the law will apply it. Okay? So this is something mandatory. Okay? Meaning that the anti-avoidant law will apply the moment that the condition fulfilled. Okay, is mandatory, is not discretionary. Now, general anti-avoidant is discretionary. So discretionary in the sense that the director general will have a power to decide whether or not he wants to exercise this power. Okay, that the director general has power to decide whether to exercise such a law. So the main difference is it's discretionary. Now, so very simple, and this is always the most well quoted example. Okay, examiners also use this all the time. Okay, if you look at a specific anti-avoidant, for instance, if you look at employment income, we have a category of employee that we always give a lot of special treatment. That will be non-service director of control company. Okay, so you just tell me how different is this. If let's say non-service director of control company, they are given living accommodation benefit. So the 13(1)(c), how do you determine? You follow what? Usually, how do you determine 13(1)(c)? What's the usual rule? You take what? The normal one is 30% of your 13(1)(a) compare with defined value, and you choose what? Choose what? Lower. Now, you see, when the moment you choose lower, it's always benefiting the taxpayer, because it's based on lower. Can you see not? Now, so in this case, as a non-service director of control company, if you choose the lower, then you actually open up an opportunity for them to avoid taxes. Now, why? Now, you just imagine, if I take 30% of my 13(1)(a) with defined value and choose the lower. Now, as a non-service director of a control company, now, a control company is those small company, right? Correct, huh? What's a control company? How many shareholders maximum? 50. Controlled by maximum 5%. So usually all the small and remember, 2-3 shareholder, family owned, they're all control company. Okay, so, you know? So it's like you are the owner of the company. Okay? And the non-service director is what? Service director cannot own more than how many percent share? 5% ordinary share, correct? Right? So a non-service is those that own a lot of share, right? Let's say I own 50% share of this X and Rambler, huh? I'm a non-service director. That means I'm the owner. Practically, you think and see, okay? That you are the owner of the company, okay? But if I'm the owner of the company, I decide how much salary I want to take. Can or not? Can, right? Now, can I give myself ₱1 a year? Why not? I believe you, those of you who do tax audit, you come across a lot of Sendrian Berhad that the dieters got not getting any salary, no fee, the whole year they don't take anything. They don't mind what, is it not? So imagine if the dieters is nothing, 13.1A is zero, or ₱1 lah, huh? Take ₱1. 30% of ₱1 is 30 cents. Now in tax, there's no decimal point when you compute the income tax. So 30 cents rounded to zero. That means it's still zero, right? So zero compared with anything, the lower is still zero, right? That means your accommodation is not taxed already. Now, that's avoidant already, right? So you think and see, that's avoided. Because I look at your law, that's how your law is being designed. Then for that, I purposely make sure that I don't get salary as a director. Now, I want money, it's very simple. I can get a company to pay me dividend. Dividend is single tier, it's not subject to tax. Is it not? So that's why they know that this is a loophole because of the problem called lower. Now, that's the reason why very specifically they mention in the law that if you're a non-service director of control company, what do you use? You use defined value. You don't compare. And is this thing mandatory or discretionary? It's mandatory, right? Correct enough? You don't choose what? Agree or not? It's not that, oh, the director general wants, then they do it. If not, they don't do it. No, it's mandatory. The moment you look at non-service director of CC, this rule will definitely apply. Now, that is called specific anti-avoidant, okay? Now, but at the same time, you know that we will just not possible to have all the anti-avoidant listed in the law. That's why the government also need to have some insurance to protect them. That in case, if there's anything they overlook, then can they have another law to catch you or not? That's the law that we're going to see called the general anti-avoidant, which is under section 140. Now, this is what they say in 140. See, 140 basically says that when director general has reason to believe, okay? Now, the law say the director general must have reason to believe. That means it's not that something he wants to do, he can do it all the time. He must have something that he use it as a basis to justify his authority, that he want to use this section 140. He must have reason. Okay? So you must give him a reason. Alright? Now, if you believe that there's effect of altering incident of tax, you relieve any person from any tax liability, you evaded, avoided any duty or liability, hinder or prevent operation of the act. Now, if he believe that there's any of these occur, then he can make use of the power given in section 140 that he may, that means it's up to him, right? It's discretionary. He may disregard vary transaction. See, he can ignore it. Okay, he can ignore it. And then what he does is he can make adjustment that he thinks fit, so that he will counteract the effect of your transaction. Okay? Now, you work in all these small firm. Usually when the client tell the auditor, hey, I don't want to pay so much tax, then the auditor will tell the client, you give me a few IC number, then I charge as salary. See, your laugh means you know this is what they do, right? Huh? Guess you're not, okay? Give me a few IC number, then we charge as salary. So then they do what? Father la, mother la, uncle la, auntie la, can see or not? 6 years old also can give IC, crazy fella, can see or not? So they start to give you all these names and so-called identity that they charge out as salary. So you just imagine what happened right now, okay? That we have A. Sendrian Berhad, that in substance, Mr. A is the shareholder, as well as the director. Okay, so I want to reduce the profit of the business so that I don't have to pay a lot of taxes. Now what you can do is you can give yourself a director fee. Okay, you give yourself a director fee. Now when you give yourself a director fee, we cannot argue. Whatever fee you want to pay yourself is up to you. You think you're worth 50,000, you draw 50,000. You think you're worth 200, you draw 200. It's up to you. 1 million also can, okay? But whatever you pay to yourself, then you will be taxed as well, right? Under employment income. So that's why usually you don't pay so much. Then your income tax is very high. So in that case, one problem solved already. You give yourself a fee or a salary, then you reduce the income of the company, you increase your own personal tax. Now, but you still find that company got a lot of profit. So what they do is now they start to charge out a lot of expenses, like all these salaries to family members, sister, brother, uncle, auntie, all their names will go into payroll. Okay, now so when you start charging out salary to family member, see, there's nothing wrong for you to employ your family member. It's okay, man. You can, because you know. But when you do it, you must do it as though it's arm's length. That means if you don't employ a family member, you employ an outsider, will you do the same thing? That's what we are asking. If you employ an outsider, you're going to pay the same amount of salary. Then I don't think there's any questions we're going to argue. But now what happened is, let's say, you employ your wife as a clerk. Okay, you put her position as a clerk. And then you pay her a salary of 4,000 per month. Now it's 4,000 and not 400. Okay, as a clerk, 4,000 per month. You think is reasonable or not? By Malaysian standard, no. It's too low, right? Too low or too high? Too high. So what do you think a clerk should be getting there? 1,006. Okay, fine. You say it's 1,006. So you believe that a fair amount is 1,006. Very expensive clerk, 1,006. Alright? Now never mind lah. So you believe it's 1,006. So the director general, when they come to you, they look at tax affair, they realize that wife is your family members, connected person. And then they start to look at what is this wife doing in the business. You say it's a clerk. Fine, alright, fine, you can employ your wife. Then they start to look at the salary, it's 4,000. Wow, this salary 4,000 is excessive. Now, that is already a good basis, eh? That there's a reason for them to believe that what you're doing here is to alter incident of tax. You're trying to reduce your income. They say overpay your wife, because you know. So this is a reason. Now, in fact, they can even look at the substance. Do you actually take out your checkbook every month, pay your wife 4,000? So if you only label that your wife is a clerk, and then the cash flow never leave the business, that is another story, you know. Then they will say that, you're not employing your wife. Where's your salary? You employ an outsider, you do that kind of. Your boss said, I employ you, but I don't pay you the money. But every month I say I give you 5,000 salary. Kind of. Where got such thing? You must pay me, right? So the substance is, where is the actual amount? There's no actual amount. Then they look at it, where's your wife? They come for tax audit, man. You say your wife is working as a clerk. Which one is your wife? They say wife at home sleeping. Can you know? And then your wife is not working. That means whatever you say is not true already. Can you know? Now all these will become a basis for the director general as a reason to believe what you're doing here could be a way of altering your taxes. Now then what they can do is they can use section 140, right, to disregard. So what they can do to disregard, example, the DG can use section 140 and do what? To disallow the excessive salary for deduction. Example, we add back 2,004 per month. That's on condition if every month you issue 4,000 and give to your wife. Imagine when they do audit that time and check, they didn't even see amount leaving the business. That the 4,000 is just an accounting adjustment. They just put in the account 4,000 go to wife, but the money never paid. Then in that case, what they can even do is totally 4,000 disallowed. Langsung cannot deduct. Also can. This is their power. Because the power given in the law is the director general may disregard and make adjustment that he think fit. He doesn't need to ask you. Can you see or not? So he just believe that this is fit. So I'll do it. Follow not? Okay. That is the power given in 140. Follow? Now, so when you want to do any tax planning, you have to remember to protect ourselves from section 140, number one, whatever you do, make sure that is bona fide, is real, is genuine. So don't just claim that your wife is working in the business. You gotta make sure that she comes to work, because you know, so every day must come and then punch the clock card, punch in, punch out, put up an evidence, okay, that she's coming for work. Now you must have economic substance, actual payment is very important. Without payment, then how do you say this is real? So you gotta make sure every month the salary payment goes to the wife, the check is being issued, okay? And you have to make sure that whatever amount is at arm's length. Arm's length means if you're dealing with an independent person, how much would it be? Like I say, Clark, you say 1,006. So you pay her 1,006, huh? You don't pay her 4,000. Huh? Can you see now? Okay? Now, once you do it in this way, then you will have good reason to protect yourself. Then the director general will find it very difficult to have a reason for him to believe that you've altered incident of tax. Can you see now? Now, if he doesn't have a good reason, then when you want to use this law, then again, he's abusing his power. Then you can challenge him. Can you see now? So this is what you must do. Remember that. Okay? Now, so this is the small part of getting you an idea about what is called tax planning, okay? Tax avoidant evasion, and what is called anti-avoidant. Now, we're gonna see a very small area on tax planning about remuneration package. Okay, now the basic idea is having a large sum of salary is not tax efficient. Okay, having a large sum of salary is not tax efficient. Why? Because the income is fully accessible to tax. Okay, income is fully accessible to tax. See, whatever money you earn as an employee, the purpose is you want to spend it. Okay, so end of the day, whether you pay yourself to buy the things that you want, or the boss actually pay and buy and give it to you, in substance is the same, right? Because you know, for example, if I employ a maid at home, okay, so I employ a maid every month, it costs me, let's say, 1,000 ringgit. Now, if I employ myself, that means I take salary, and then I go and employ a maid. So every month I'll take from my income and pay 1,000 to the maid. Now why not the employer employ the maid for me and the employer give me the maid? So the employer will cut 1,000 from my salary, but when I get a maid, my extra income is how much? Benefit of a maid, how much? Per month is? Job by maid, servant. Six, there's a driver. 400 per month, right now? Now, you cut 1,000, you replace back with 400. So effectively, you still get what you want, right? You just want a maid, right? But to you, the effect in tax is what? You save 600 of income. then your tax will reduce. So this is what we're trying to do. Okay, so we try to do a tax planning by restructuring your package. So when we want to restructure the package, so what we're going to do usually is we take your gross salary. I'll cut the pay and I'll replace with, now example, exam income. See, there are quite a number of things for employees exempted, right? Traveling allowance, how much a year? 6,000. So why not just ask the employer and change their policy that now we will start giving traveling allowance to worker, give all worker a traveling allowance, but then at the same time you tell them that to give you a traveling allowance we'll have a pay cut. So I give you 500 traveling allowance a month, but I cut 500 from your salary, but eventually to the worker the 6,000 is exempted, which is better, right? See, I didn't cut your salary, end of the day I give you back the same thing. This is on paper, that instead of calling them salary, I divide now into two things, salary and traveling allowance. The effect is allowance is exempted, so it's better, right? That is what we're trying to do. Okay, now not only replace with exam income, we replace with BIK, that the PV is often lower than the economic cost. Okay, see, I just told you earlier, right, the servant PV is only 400. You tell me 400 a servant, how to get 600 a driver? If you can employ a driver at 600 ringgit, you better don't sit in the car, because you go up or go down very fast. On, because you know, okay, so end of the day, you know the actual amount is definitely higher, one, but the BIK value is lower. So we swap. So this is what we're gonna do. Okay, now when you swap, there's a few things you must look out for, lah. Okay. Now first is issue on the car. Okay. Now, see, most of us, we're gonna buy a car. Okay. So you can also do this. Instead of you buy the car, arrange and negotiate with the employer to have the company buy the car. Okay, whatever agreement you sign, okay, sign an agreement with the employer that you get the company to buy a car, you employ for X number of years, at the end sell back the car to you at a nominal value. So as long as you put them black and white, you should find it okay, right? Is it not? Okay? So the eventual objective is to save tax money. So you can have a car, that the employer will buy a car using your own money by having a pay cut and then give you back as a car benefit. But when you say buy a car and give it back as a car benefit, now how much that this car worth and how much deduction we're going to adjust from you. Now let's say this car is worth 240,000. Now let's say you intend to drive the car for 6 years. Okay, now after that you want to change your car. So we take 6 years depreciation. So effectively, it will cost about 40,000 a year, okay? So you get about 40,000 a year. So this 40,000 a year is what we will reduce your pay. Okay, we will reduce your pay by 40,000. And then we give this car to you as a benefit. So if the car benefit that the value is worth 240, how much is the BIK value? You follow your BIK table for the car. 240. The value is 9,000. Okay? So you will see your 13.1B, the BIK PV for car, will be 9,000. Now the maths is very clear cut, right? You reduce by 40, you increase by 9. And obviously, you must understand that this is only a theory that we explain over here. I mean, in real life, you think your employer will agree to reduce by 40? Eh? Your interest? Eh? You take a hard purchase, you will pay interest. Eh? You say no? So if we factor in, probably you reduce more than 40. So imagine I reduce 45,000 for you a year, and then you only increase 9,000. This is a lot of taxes you're going to save. Eh? You say no? This is what we're going to do. So this issue about car. Okay. Now, so once you start converting salary into all these things, you start to see your salary will go down. So by the time when your salary go down until the final amount, then the next thing we're going to do adjustment is your EPF. Okay, now you can revise employer's EPF from the usual 12% to 19%. Now the logic why 19 is because section 34 allow a maximum deduction up to only 19. So anything above that, the employer will not get a deduction. So that's why employer may not agree. Okay, their employer will not get a deduction. So employer may not agree. Follow not? Okay. So that's why to us is it must be win-win to both sides. That to the employer there'll be no effect. To you, you get an exemption. Follow not? Okay. Now, so why? Why we increase this from 12 to 19 is because later on, when the employee withdraw from the EPF, the EPF withdrawal by the employee, because this is an approved fund, you've no tax to pay. Okay. So you have save tax on this portion. Now, how do you do it? It's quite simple. Let's say example. Let's say right now, you draw a 10,000 salary a month. So you get 120,000 gross. Okay? So on the 120,000, your employer contributes 12%. Okay? So employer's EPF, 12%. Is 134,400. Now, end of the day, whatever you adjust, as long as the amount come back to 134,400, the employer will not complain, right? Fair enough? You're not asking me to pay you more, right? You want me to do all the adjustment inside, I don't mind. But end of the day, what I pay you must be the same. So initially, I pay you 134,400. Now, I also pay you 134,400. And initially, all these amount I can deduct. That's why now I'm going to make sure this amount also I can deduct. So in that case, there's no issue. So what we want to do is what? We want to change the 12 into 19. So how do you change 12 into 19? Now, you are determining this amount, right? So how do you determine this amount? Now this amount is a gross salary, the 100%. So 100 plus 19 equals to 119. Now this is 100% plus 12%. So this is 112. They say if I ask you that the amount is 134,400, if your employer contribute at 12%, then how much is the salary? They say you take 134,400 divided by 1.12 is 120. No? So how do you get this amount then? So you just take 134,400 divided by 1.19. So you know that the amount would be 112,941. So somewhere around there. Now, so if 112,941, your 19% should be 21,459. That's why eventually the amount must come to 134,400. See, your boss is not giving extra money. So you're not asking your boss to give you more salary, no. He's just adjusting your amount. So that at the end, it will come to 19. that the total is still the same. Follow not? Okay. Now when you do it in this way, you notice what happened is your salary reduced already. Right? From 120, you only get 112. So you get less amount, you pay less tax. But the money you get is the same, because this amount goes into EPF. So the only difference, or the only disadvantage is what? You cannot use the money first. Huh? You gotta wait. Huh? But now there's a lot of way of withdrawing, right? The 30% you can withdraw. Huh? You can buy a house, pay for your study, you can withdraw. Huh? So in that case, you find that there's a bit of disadvantage. But you're using this to exchange what? An elimination of tax. That this amount, langsung, don't need to pay tax. Follow me? Okay? Now all that is what we do here to do with adjusting EPF contribution rate. Okay, we're gonna see an example. Huh? This is an old past year that I've modified, okay, added something inside. Okay, page 216. Now, requirement is A. Propose a more tax efficient package. And you list down element to be contained in the package, but you must not introduce element that's not mentioned in the scenario. So you just follow exactly in the context of the question. Don't invent any extra thing. Show what's the yearly economic cost of each element of your proposed package that total to 448,000. Then you calculate what's the amount of the revised salary to offer to Encik Chiu. And please assume that the depreciation rate of the car is 20%. Now for any item that is that's mentioned in the scenario but is not included in your proposed remuneration, give your reasoning why. Compute the tax payable by Encik Chiu for the year of assessment based on the proposed package. Okay, we read the question. Okay, now Chiu been offered an employment with Luxtel with a salary of 400,000 per annum. Now he's getting a lot of cash, 400,000 a year. And that's including the EPF at 12%. So it comes in total to 448. That's what the employer is paying. And now they tell you Encik Chiu will pay for all these things himself. Okay, he will take his salary and he'll buy a new car, 180. He pay for his petrol. He'll be parking his car in the commercial car park at 300 ringgit a month. He employ a driver, a furnished house. Okay, he's gonna rent a house in the 2,000, 6,000 with furniture. Individual membership for golf club, that the entrance fee is 30, subscription is 3. Cost of air travel for overseas holiday, personal computer, domestic servant, meal and food, reasonable amount. Now you know there are quite a number of things here that actually if you get the employer to give it to you, is more efficient, right? Car, for example, driver, petrol. So that's why we try to suggest to Chiu that we restructure. Take less salary and have the employer to pay for all these things. Now, but not everything that you want the employer to give you. For example, membership. The club membership, if you ask the employer to give you, end of the day, there's no difference, right? Now, I cut your salary by 30,000. Okay? Then I give you a club membership. Now, but in your tax, you're going to put back the 30,000 or so, right? So there's no difference. And then in that case, don't waste time. And then this one, don't want. Okay? Now, there are certain things that even you find that is good to you, but the employer may not agree. Now, for example, like leave passage. Do you leave passage is good because you get exemption, correct? Not? Overseas, how much? 3,000. But section 39 says that you got no deduction, right? Employer will not get deduction for giving leave passage to employee. The only deduction for leave passage is which one? The local passage that all the worker, family members, employer will go together and is once a year, correct? Not? But this is definitely not the case. So in that case, to you is good, but the employer may not agree. So in that case, I'll say that this one we exclude also. So I explain my reason why that there's no deduction for the employer, okay? Now, so this is what we're gonna do now. So A, Okay, the proposed package. Now we propose that Encik Chiu 400,000 cash base salary to be reduced by 1 equivalent amount of the following, where Luxtel shall provide you as a form of benefit or perquisite. Okay, one. Reduced by the depreciation value of the car. To provide him a car benefit. Okay. Now, to provide him fuel benefit at 6,000 ringgit a year. Okay, now to employ a driver at the yearly cost of 10,860 and provide you a driver benefit. Okay, replace at the equivalent amount with parking allowance 3,600 a year. Now, not only the parking allowance is exempted, the food allowance also exempted, and the food allowance at 6,000 a year. Okay, to provide him a fully furnished accommodation rented by Luxtel at a total cost of 78,000, which of course you then reduce the pay by 78,000. Now computer, there's no different. The employer gets no deduction. The employee is taxed in full, so no point. The travel also no deduction. The membership also, okay. Now the servant, okay, to provide him a servant to be employed at a cost of 14,400 a year. Okay, now then based on the reduced salary to further revise the EPF contribution by Luxtel from 12 to 19%. Which of course, after you adjust this EPF contribution, your salary will become even lower. Okay, just explain on that. Alright, now this is the package. So this is a more efficient package. So now they say show individually that all these things you say here, how much is the cost, that how much will the revised salary be. Okay, so that's part B lah. So usually A and B must come together lah. If not, then how do you know how much you're going to propose, right? So now B, we're going to compute what's the revised salary. Now the economic cost to Luxtel is 448. Now follow exactly what we just say here, right? So I will minus the depreciation of the car, which is 20%, and the value is 180. So there's a cut of 36,000. Then later you tax the car benefit. Okay, the fuel benefit is 6,000. The driver cost is 10,860. Parking allowance is 36. Food allowance is 6,000. Accommodation and furniture is 78. And the cost of the servant, 14,004. So by the time you cut down your salary for all these things, this is what left: 293,140. Now this amount, is it inclusive of EPF or not? Yes, because when I started with 448, correct not? So 448 is inclusive of EPF. There's a 239,140 is also inclusive of EPF. Okay, so this will be the salary inclusive of EPF. But the EPF is a how many percent? Now of course it's based on 12% originally, but end of the day you want to revise this to 19. Follow? Okay? So long that the total amount remain the same as what the employer originally is paying you, then the employer got no problem. So it's just revised back to 19. So by dividing back to 1.19, this is your revised gross salary. So you get something like 246 1336. Okay, now, so they say whatever we excluded, explain why. So that's part C, yeah. Right, I've excluded the club membership and the computer, okay? Now the club membership, why? That CHIL will be accessible in full. The value of the club membership paid by Luxtel. So there's no tax advantage to CHIL. Okay, so there's no different, right? That's why don't need lor. Okay, number two. The personal computer. Now, CHIL will be accessible in full. The value of the computer. And not only that, right? Luxtel will not get a tax deduction on the cost of providing the free PC to CHIL. So to CHIL is no advantage, but to company is disadvantageous. Okay, because you will not get deduction. Now the overseas leave passage. Although CHIL can enjoy a tax exemption of 3,000 for overseas leave passage, Luxtel is not given a deduction. On the cost of leave passage to employee. So this is disallowed by section 39. Okay? So it's specifically disallowed by law. So Luxtel is unlikely to agree to this. So that's why we believe that it's difficult, okay, for Luxtel to agree to give this thing to you. So end up Luxtel is going to lose.
Hello.
Yeah.
The first one is there's no tax advantage to you. There's tax advantage to you.
But there's no tax advantage. Where's the no? The no disappeared. Okay, so this is my reasoning why we excluded the three items, okay? Okay, so now in D, they ask us to work out the tax payable based on your proposed package. Now this is employment. based on the proposed package just now, salary will be 246,336. Now it's just very few things, we just list down everything here, okay? Now besides salary, what else we have under 13.1A? Now we have parking allowance, which is tax exempt. We have food allowance, which is tax exempt as well. That's all right. Okay. Now car benefit. So the cost of the car is 180,000. So the BIK table shows that the car is assessed at 7K. Okay. Now besides having car, you are given petrol. For exemption up to 6,000 apply. PV for driver is 600. So 72. Now the house come with furniture, so the PV is 280 for fully furnished. So 280 times 12. So it's 3360. Servant PV is 400 48. That's it lah. Okay, so all benefits done already. Right, then 13.1C. Now your value of living accommodation is 30% of your 1A. This is 73,901 with the defined value, which is 72. So you take the lower 72. Now in this case it's no different, okay, because you still come back to 72. But if your 1A has a lower amount, then probably the 30% is below 72, then you save a bit. But you definitely save on the furniture, because furniture is only assessed at 3360, but your reduction is 6,000 a year. There's some saving there. Okay. So there's a gross adjusted statutory aggregate total. That's it. Alright, now we claim relief, right? So tax relief, the personal deduction 9,000, the EPF maximum 6,000. Computer, forgot. He's gonna buy a computer. Maximum 3,000. So the CI will be 322,696. Alright, so what's your TP? Now on the first 100,000, the tax would be 13850. I just calculate like that, okay? So the balance 222,696 at 26%. So you pay 71,750.96.
So this is how much tax you pay after we restructure his package.
Now without restructuring, they be assuming that the full amount of 400,000 is what Chiu is getting. How much tax that Chiu will be paying? Now just work out very quickly, okay? So if based on the original amount of 400, so full amount subject to tax, right? So the 400 will become your total income. So if the 400 is your total income, you minus 9,000 for relief, 6,000 EPF and 3,000 for computer. So the 400 minus all the 3, you get 382. Now, so 382, your tax will be 282 times 26 plus 13850. So in that case, your tax payable is 87,170. Now, this is how much you're going to pay if based on the original amount, okay? And compare with this 71,750, you actually save 15,419.04.
Okay? So it can be quite substantial. 15,000. 1 year you can go for quite a good holiday. And the government give you one. Okay?
Alright, now that's a bit on how you do restructuring of remuneration package. Last time is compulsory question.
Nowadays
very rare. Yeah. In fact, came out in P6. There was I think 3 sittings back. Came out in P6. All right. So trend. Okay. But it's still in syllabus. Still in syllabus. That's why you still need to know. Okay. All right. We take a break.